right, our next question comes from Greg White of Phoenix. Would you like me to ask your question for you?
Ask it,
you'll ask it? Okay.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you both ladies for coming here. It's been so appreciated. The Federal Reserve is the chief culprit behind the economic crisis. The sunshine power to create endless amounts of money out of thin air bubbles is booming in the bust cycles, causing our financial bubble one minute after another. Since the Fed's creation in 1913, the dollar has lost them more than 96% of its value. And by recklessly inflating the monetary supply, the Fed continues to distort interest rates and initially arranged for lowering the value of the dollar. My question is to both of you ladies. Is, do you support Ron Paul's bill, H.R. 1207, the bill to audit the Federal Reserve? And secondly, I would just like to say, Ms. Merkel, I'm very disappointed that you did sign on to the NDAA. I believe that's unconstitutional to hold and betray any one of us that they deem that is a terrorist or supporting a terrorist. They can take us off the street, put us into a prison, into a black hole, and you'll never ever be seen again. It's unfathomable that you would even vote for that and then say the Constitution in the same words. Thank you very much.
I did vote for Ron Paul's bill. It did pass out of the House to audit the Federal Reserve, and hopefully the Senate will do something.
Is that a hairy week to bring it on the floor?
Yes, it is.
How can you pressure Harry Reid to bring it on the floor? He's been saying he's been forced since 1987. Now, all of a sudden, when we can really find out what the Senate was assuming, nothing's happened.
It's very difficult to get the Senate to do anything. As you know, they haven't passed a budget since 2009, and this is one of the bills that's laying over there in the dark hole. And it is. It's a dereliction.
This was still in Congress. Is the fact.
Federal Reserve. I do want to make a comment because we talk about what caused the 2008 meltdown. I think we've got to look carefully, because out of that we have Dodd-Frank, which is really hurting financial institutions and banks and impairing, again, another wedge in the economy that doesn't allow the economy to get going. You know, there were policies in place, and from President Carter and forward, that really encouraged home ownership. And it said to the banks, you've got to lend money. And people who probably weren't qualified to own a home, they were encouraged, and the banks were encouraged to lend them money. That was the genesis of the meltdown, because the banks lent money, and when Fannie and Freddie stepped up and federally guaranteed those loans, you then had Wall Street, and this is where Wall Street came in. Wall Street came in and started selling those, bundling those mortgages and selling. And that, so it was policies out of the federal government were the beginning of that meltdown, and then it was Wall Street working right alongside the bundling. They thought the federal government's guaranteeing those mortgages. Let's get rid of them and sell them and make some money. So, and as a result of that, we got Dodd-Frank, which doesn't address Fannie, it doesn't address Freddie. It's like overkill that doesn't really get to the root of the problem. I think we've got to be concerned with what really caused that meltdown and avoid that to happen again. I agree with you. I think the Federal Reserve is a big part of this problem. They should be audited. They should be held accountable for their monetary policies. And they're not at this point. They're unaccountable to anyone. With regards to the NDAA, we heard loud and clearly the concerns, and that's why we pushed so hard to get that Landry Amendment passed, which addressed the language that people were concerned that their civil rights were going to be violated, or their, and so that's why we voted for and pushed the Landry Amendment to deal with the issue that you're talking about.
And I think I want to take the issue of the NDAA a little bit further, because you brought up this idea that people can get, you know, snatched up and held and detained for, you know, indefinitely. And I think that's a serious problem. And we're seeing it. I think I want to bring up right now the case of Private Bradley Manning, who is being held for attempting to expose the war crimes of the U.S. government in Iraq. So we need to be celebrating and protecting people that dare to tell the truth about U.S. government abuses, not punishing them like what's happening to Bradley Manning right now. Reports have come out that he's been, you know, he's basically been tortured in prison by the U.S. government, and we should not be torturing members of the military that are exposing abuse. We should be protecting them and helping amplify their voices so that people are not afraid to speak out against abuses by the federal government. And this, I think, would apply to, I think it would encourage whistleblowers that work in financial industries that were involved in the financial meltdown as well. So I think that just takes the NDAA a little bit further. And ultimately, I think we need to have more democratic control over the Federal Reserve and more oversight of our monetary policy.
Our next question is from John Clare of Camillus. John, are you here? Would you like me to? Okay. What are the key things you will do to reduce unemployment?
Thanks for your question, John. Where are you? Hi. Well, I mentioned earlier in my introduction that I'm very concerned about unemployment, especially, you know, the chronic, persistent unemployment that we've seen in the city and in rural areas. And so a big part of my platform is a public jobs program, like the New Deal, like what got us out of the Depression, to put people back to work through direct government employment, to meet all the unmet community needs throughout our district. It helped get us out of the Great Depression, and I think it can get us back to work right now. And it's a pretty, you know, it's a pretty radical idea to think, oh, instead of cutting more taxes for the so-called job creators, let's just put people to work. But you know what? The job creators, they're not creating jobs. These big energy companies like BP, Exxon, Chevron, that we say are supposed to be creating jobs in the energy industry, they had profits of over $500 billion in the past 5 years, and they've cut their workforce in the United States. So I think that we need to send a signal to private business, because if people are unemployed, they can't spend money. I think it's very basic economics. So with a public employment program, we can target jobs to the sectors that really need employment. You know, communities of color, rural areas where people have been out of work for a long time, and we can see what community needs there are to be met. You know, I'm sure someone worked on that road that I drove down to get to this town hall, and I'm sure there's roads just like that that could use work and people that are ready and willing to work. So I think that we need to look at unemployment and think about how can we solve it, and the quickest way to put people back to work is through a public jobs program. Because we have to face the fact that the job creators just aren't doing it, and if people don't have jobs, they can't spend it, and they can't stimulate the economy. So I think we need positive government action, and our proposal is called a Green New Deal, to basically create public jobs to transition us to a renewable economy.
We tried a public jobs program with the stimulus. We spent $860 billion of your money, close to a trillion with the interest, and we still have had 42 months of unemployment at or above 8%. We invested $90 billion into the solar panel, renewable energy, and many of those companies went bankrupt. Many of those jobs went over to China. So I don't think we can rely on the federal government for jobs, because is the private sector. And when I talk about jobs, and when I talk about releasing capital and not raising taxes on business owners, I'm talking about the small businesses in upstate New York, the electric supply company in Syracuse who's got 40 employees, the rental, we just toured on Friday, a large, they lease out a rental construction equipment. Family-owned businesses who pay a personal income tax, and when you raise taxes on those making $200,000 or $250,000 or even $1 million, you are raising taxes. Probably 50 or 60% of those people are small business owners who hire people, who create jobs, who buy inventory, who expand their businesses, who put people back to work. Those are real jobs. The government can't create jobs. The government needs to get out of the way and allow and create an environment where someone who has a dream And that's the essence of America. Someone who has a dream in their heart or an idea. You know, the Steve Jobs, that's the big one. But there's a lot of small guys who have a dream and they want to make a product. And every time they take a step, the federal government's in their way to either regulate them or tax them. And so they become discouraged and they give up looking for work or trying to grow their dream. The best thing this government can do is to get out of the way and create an environment where someone who is wants to have a bite at that American dream, the essence of America, can do that without the government standing right in the way. This country does not have a taxing problem. This country has a spending problem.
Yeah.
It spends. Your way out of this debt. You can't even seize the wealth of all the wealthiest people. It will not pay down this debt. We need a pro-growth economic agenda that inspires the private sector, not the government, to do what they do best, and that's create jobs.
All right, we have time for two more questions, and there's actually two more questions in the basket. But before that, someone left a cell phone at the reception table, so if you're missing your cell phone, it's back there. And our next question is from Darla DeLorme of Fulton.
My topic was already discussed, so I'm changing it to what would you say, what is your opinion of the federal government's role in education?
Thank you for your question, Darla. That's a great question. I think that we should minimize the role of the federal government and give the money and the authority to the states and to the local states. That's very different from what Dan Maffei says. I'm against public education. I am so pro-public education. I've raised 6 kids in public schools and private schools, and I understand education. And I also understand that the needs of school districts vary from district to district. And the federal government, and this is why it's so important that the federal government only be involved in legitimate roles.